Well, good afternoon. In case you were here this morning and were confused, I am not the Prime Minister of Canada. We're often confused, really. I mean, we look so much alike. But hope you enjoyed the session. Hope you've gotten a lot out of, as I expect you might have, last night and today. Thank you for being here. More important, thank you for what you do day in, day out. I'm a big believer that education is the ladder in this society, and in many ways, our future as a democracy and as everything else, as an economy, as a society, depends upon education. So thank you for making the choice that you have made. I don't have a big agenda for this meeting. I want it to be useful for you all. We've made education, as I alluded to this morning, and as I think you've sensed during the day, a priority for us. We didn't used to be in the education business except peripherally. And we've decided to, just over a decade or so ago, that as good as what we were doing, we thought, with the magazine Foreign Affairs, with the books, the articles that our fellows were doing, the meetings for our members, that left out approximately 330 million Americans. And we thought maybe, just maybe, we should not do less of what we'd always been doing, but add an arrow to the quiver and basically add a new mission. And that's what we did. And we've done it through dedicated learning resources, the World 101, the Model Diplomacy, the Project for Younger People with iCivics, convene the council. We do it with all the explainers and the like on the website. Turns out it's the most trafficked part of the website. We didn't design it that way, it just turns out to be, which I take as a very useful market signal that people actually want straight information and analysis that they can trust. For example, we're coming up on a big debate over the debt and so forth, and whether and how to finance it, how to raise the ceiling. Well, it's not obvious exactly what's going on, what's being voted on, what are the consequences of not doing it, how did we get here, what are the implications, and so forth. So it's the kind of area I feel that we can make a real contribution. The magazine, I still believe, is a useful educational tool, though it's fairly demanding. Arena, we've also started setting up these various outreach programs several times a year around the country, where we have conversations. I think the next one's on Ukraine policy, how to think about the choices. Yeah, so again, we've made what I guess we call global literacy a priority here, and we are going to continue that far into the future. I've also made it something of a personal priority, in addition to that, to focus on what you might call civics literacy, hence my new book, The Bill of Obligations. I realize I'm a foreign policy guy, pretty much. I plead guilty to that. Been doing it for more decades than I'm comfortable with. But I don't see how you separate the two. If I were looking at the history of the last, three quarters of a century since American entry into World War II, I would say it's been a remarkable run of history by any and every measure, just about. Not that we haven't made mistakes, but the overall accomplishments are quite extraordinary. And very little of it would have happened without the United States. Not that we did it alone, but we played an outsized role. And in part, we were able to play that outsized role in the world because of certain conditions here at home. And what concerns me going forward is those conditions may no longer exist, or certainly exist to the extent they have. And that if we can't do that, if that's right, then we won't be able to play a large role in the world. And if we can't, things in the world will continue to move in the direction, to choose my favorite word from another book, disarray. And if that happens, it will end up making troubled conditions here at home even more troubled. One of my favorite cliches is if what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, that may be true, but what happens in the world doesn't stay out there. It comes here. And again, it will affect what we're able to do. So it ends up being a loop. What happens here affects the world. If things go badly here, we can't set an example. Others will want to emulate. We just had, for example, the I was there yesterday in Washington for the visit of the South Korean president, President Yoon. What was the central issue on the agenda? Interesting. It was not his rendition of Don McLean's American Pie, but it was, which was pretty impressive, Wednesday night. What was the central item on the agenda was extended deterrence. Here is South Korea facing the two fastest growing nuclear arsenals in the world, North Korea and China. North Korea has been a fast-growing nuclear arsenal for years because that's basically the only thing North Korea can do. That's their that's how when they do station identification, the rest of the world listens. China decided to really ramp up its nuclear arsenal. Ironically enough, as best we can tell, it was growing, but then took a major accelerant because of Ukraine. Why? From China's point of view, the reason the United States and NATO are not on the ground directly helping Ukraine but are only helping Ukraine indirectly is because the Russians have the largest nuclear arsenal in the world. I'm not saying that's a correct assessment, but I'm saying it seems to be the Chinese assessment based upon all we can tell. And as a result, China is investing heavily in the buildup of its nuclear program, in part with Russian help. The reason being that I believe they are hoping that if a Taiwan crisis were to materialize, that by having a much larger nuclear force, they would be able to persuade us to limit any help for Taiwan to indirect help rather than direct American military participation. And they believe correctly that if they could do that, they would prevail. Now, I think it's an incorrect assessment about why we're doing or not doing what we're doing in Ukraine and what we would do or not do what we would do in a Taiwan crisis. I'm just saying, but one of the reasons South Korea, I was trying to remember my thread here. So why though is South Korea now thinking differently? Because they faced a nuclear North Korea for years. They faced a nuclear China for years. They have no nuclear weapons. U.S. nuclear weapons were taken off the peninsula just over 30 years ago. We withdrew them. I think it was 91. I might be wrong on that. I'm pretty sure it was 1991. South Korea no longer has the confidence it had in America's nuclear guarantees. For those of you who are my vintage, you'll remember de Gaulle, and when he was president of France, he basically said, there's no way that if Paris is threatened, you're gonna step up and put New York on the firing line. As a result, we need our own force de frappe, our own independent nuclear deterrent. 70% of the people in South Korea think the same thing. The public opinions poll show. Now, we don't want them to go down that road. We obviously don't want to see the spread of nuclear weapons. So as a result, we've had to reassure South Korea more involvement in the decision-making process, more involvement, and more visits to the region by American nuclear forces. But what was the critical factor in influence in creating this new uncertainty in South Korea? In part, it was the Trump administration, which threatened to pull all remaining U.S. troops, about 28,500, stationed in South Korea along the DMZ to pull them all out because of frustrations that South Korea was not paying us enough for our defense support, and worried about what might happen in the future, and more broadly worried about the divisions in American politics. So what happens here has real implications. It also, I think, can't prove it, but my guess is one of the reasons Mr. Putin calculated he could invade Ukraine with a degree of impunity was, again, he tended to discount what we would do in the aftermath of January 6th and other things. So my point is simply that what happens here has tremendous foreign policy consequences. So that's sort of how I backdoored my way into my new focus. Even before January 6th, I was worried about our inability to get things done, particularly at the federal level. January 6th, though, had a fairly big impact on my thinking. Essentially, I don't know about you, but I never used to wake up in the morning worried particularly about American democracy. I have a checklist here, the things I worry about here, the things I don't. Well, it's kind of gone from one list to the other now. Never thought that would happen, but there it is. There we are. When I looked at American democracy, not a lot of time to think about. I'm not an expert on this stuff. one of the, I have to be careful how I put this, I'll just sort of say, one of the unexpected, you know, bad things sometimes have good effects. One of the good things of the pandemic, amidst all the awfulness, was that it gave me lots of time. And we have a place upstate, so I'd be walking around a lot, me and my dog, who, by the way, is appropriately named Kennan. I hope you appreciate that. What else would you expect from the head of the Council on Foreign Relations, the former head of policy planning at the State Department? But Kennan and I, and I'd be thinking a lot about these issues, and I started reading about them more and more. And I had a fantastic reading experience. One of my recommendations for those of you in the book writing business, one day think about writing a book about something you know very little about. It's the best education I ever had in writing a book. Because normally I write books about something I presumably know a little bit about, this or that foreign policy question. This was a book about something, like for example, I don't know when the last time any of you, let's see a show of hands. Well, who has read the Articles of Confederation in the last 5 years? Wow, that's more than I thought, 5 or 6 of you. That's impressive. I was not one of them, but now I am. So I reread the Articles. I reread the Federalists. I reread the Constitution. I reread all the basic documents. Then I've done some things I bet you haven't done. I read every inaugural address of our presidents. I read all the farewell addresses. Read other major presidential speeches, in part because people like Kennedy and Lincoln obviously never got to give farewell addresses. Read all sorts of Supreme Court decisions, and particularly the dissents, really often spectacular. But I decided the time had come for me to get steeped and all that. And the more I read about it, what was so interesting is this whole role for rights in American history. Constitution only got ratified because several states demanded that there be a Bill of Rights. You know, I hadn't realized all the mechanics of the ratification process, the politics of it. And one prism to view American history is that of rights. Lincoln spoke of our unfinished work. Well, to narrow the gap between the unfinished work of realizing protecting rights, delivering on that, and the reality. And that was Lincoln's message. And if you think about the 14th Amendment, 15th Amendment, you think about extending the right to vote to women, to 18-year-olds, civil rights legislation, and so forth, we have made, I would argue, real progress. Not complete. Lincoln's work is still unfinished. But we've made some strides, some important strides as a society. But what I started thinking about was imagine if, because I was also reading the papers and all that during all this, if there were a magic wand and Lincoln's unfinished work suddenly were to be finished. And the conclusion I drew is, wow, that still wouldn't be enough. Because rights collide. The rights of a woman or a mother with the rights of the unborn, rights of to bear arms pursuant to the Second Amendment, rights for public safety. I've been doing a lot of reading about public health and U.S. public health policy. Going back to smallpox, the right not to get vaccinated versus the right to public health, and decisions made early in the 19th century on that, court decisions. And so the more I thought about it, I came to the conclusion that a rights-only-based approach to American democracy would be inadequate. And when you go back and reread the Federalists and other things, it's interesting how little they have to say about obligations. But then the more I read it and thought about it, it was because when they wrote words like virtue, and at the moment, because the revolutionary experience was still so fresh, I concluded they didn't think they needed to write a lot about it. They thought it was there. And that what was missing in the political debate was rights. And that, again, particularly since we had just recently thrown off a tyranny in the form of Great Britain. Well, what's happened over the last 2-plus centuries is that the progress towards rights has fittingly happened, but obligations which were assumed are no longer being met. And so I decided that I would write a book about obligations. And the reason is that, again, not that rights are less important, but to reintroduce the notion of obligations, which for lots of political and cultural reasons, I think have been lost. This is not a society right now that's big on what we owe one another or what we owe the country tends to be much more, the arrows tend to point much more in the other direction. I expect you see that in your classrooms. To deal with that challenge, and again, lots of reasons why and how we got there, which I think are really interesting in terms of democratic backsliding in this country, and how we got to the point that we are. But what I wanted to do was encourage people, educators above all, parents, religious leaders, business leaders, essentially everyone, including politicians, but not to depend on politicians. At the end of the day, politicians may not be responsible. It's good you're sitting down. but they are responsive. So what I wanted to do was change the context in which they operate, where certain kinds of behaviors were rewarded, others were penalized. The other thing is that got me to write this is I got tired of reading all these really smart blue ribbon reports. And there are about a million out there by all these groups about how to reform American politics. Do this to gerrymandering, do this on voting, do this on the court. And these are all, depending on your politics, you may think they're wonderful ideas or not, but none of them's gonna happen. It's a little bit like UN Security Council reform. There's no person in this room who would design the Security Council we have starting today. This was the world that people 75, 80 years ago thought would be. The idea that you would have Britain and France on the Security Council, but not India, Japan, Germany, Brazil, and others, is preposterous. But just try to change it. Shockingly enough, again, it's good, you're all sitting down. Those who feel disadvantaged or threatened by change tend to resist it. That's a remarkable thought. And the same thing with political changes here in this country. I can promote any number of presumably decent ideas to deal with gerrymandering, voting, you name it, any of the branches of government. But there's no way it's going to be passed because it will have an uneven political effect. Any reform has uneven effects. And particularly those that are reforms that would change the system and weight it more in the direction of those who feel they are losing out under current arrangements, those who feel they are benefiting from current arrangements or fear they would not from alternatives will stop it. So I decided not to add to the mountain of books and papers on political reform, but instead to focus on the context in which American politics takes place, which is attitudes, behaviors. It's one step removed from the immediate. My view is these are things that could be changed, they could be taught, and that might create a context in which other things would over time become possible. Hope you look at it, happy to talk about it. And there's lots of things that can be done in classes. I mean, I think you all have tremendous opportunities to teach about information literacy, how to help people navigate this information environment we all live in, where we have more information than ever, but also more misinformation than ever. New Jersey, by the way, just became the first state in the country, nearly said the union, first state in the country, to pass a requirement for all public schools. Governor signed it into law. The public schools now teach information literacy to make people critical consumers of information. Countries like Finland already have it. So I think that's now part of a modern education. I think, obviously, we can talk about what goes into a civics curriculum. I'd be interested in your thinking about what needs to be taught. What do we mean by citizenship or civics? How do we best prepare people for democracy, for being a citizen? You know, we'd never let them graduate, pass your classes or graduate your schools if they couldn't read or write, have certain other skills. Well, why is preparing people for citizenship necessarily a lesser goal or requirement? So what can we do there? And then ways of doing it. And I think there's lots of things with debates. One of the things I proposed, I did teaching notes for this book, having a mock constitutional convention and have every student propose his or her own amendment and debate them out. I like mock things in model Congresses, mock Supreme Courts. I like things that give people a chance to participate and often switch sides at halftime. And so they hopefully get some empathy for, as well as awareness of the other set of arguments. So anyhow, I actually increasingly think for people to be prepared for a 21st century life, because you think about your students, particularly if they're anywhere from 15 to 25, if they had a good genetic inheritance and they fasten their seatbelts, they will probably have a life that will map the 21st century. My argument is that in order to have a chance of succeeding, them and as well as this country, we need them to be literate in international things, and as well as in domestic civics, other things as well. I get it. And there's pressure, lots of crowding out phenomena. But I do believe that we're not doing anybody any favors if they don't come armed to take on this or prepared to deal with the world with some grasp of the international dynamics as well as in this country, the democracy dynamics. Why don't I stop that? And anything and everything that I've mentioned, haven't mentioned, or anything else is fair game. I guess we have microphones, and people just identify themselves and where they're from. That would be great. Sir.
Yeah, Dana Radcliffe from Syracuse and Cornell.
I've heard of both. I spent a semester teaching at Hamilton, so I used to fly into Syracuse airport whenever the snow would allow.
So I'd like to follow up on something you just said. Given the interconnectedness of the world and our place in it, It seems reasonable to say that we need to be thinking of ourselves as world citizens, or at least a part of the larger world. One of the things I'm thinking about is, should we have a bill of international obligations? In other words, your book is about obligations that we have as citizens, but we're also part of the world,
sure.
And we talk about human rights, but should we also have human obligations? Maybe that should be your next book.
So I have two or three reactions to that. It's a really interesting question, by the way. Thank you. One is, one of the phrases I've banned in this slightly guided democracy here is global citizen. I do not believe in it, and I actually think it's for two reasons. One is, there's no such thing. Citizenship is conferred nationally by countries, not by the world. Second of all, it's a real turnoff to a lot of people we all want to reach, because it plays into fears about it. So you can talk about global consciousness, global awareness, global community. I don't care. But I think global citizen is a freighted, loaded phrase that I believe best avoided. What we really want are individuals and countries to work together against common challenges, but the basic organizational unit in the world is the sovereign state, and I believe that, and it's been a pretty good thing. If you think about the pre-sovereign state world before 1648, things were not all peachy keen. So I actually think sovereignty, in the largest historical sense of the word, has been an innovation that's had more positives than not. I realize when it's plugged into or merges with hypernationalism, it can be not. But sovereignty itself was an important innovation in building international order, because with it, if you look at what came out of 1648, it set the rules, and it was an idea that you've got to respect my borders, I've got to respect yours, and what goes on inside your territories is your business, not mine. Now, it's obviously been violated in any number of ways since, and wars are, interstate wars by definition are a form of violation, but without it we'd be much worse off. So I'm, as you can sense, my enthusiasm for the phrase global citizen is finite. I've written about what you said. It wasn't totally an original idea. It came from two former colleagues of mine, I'm guessing 30, 40 years ago, when I ran the foreign policy program at Brookings. And it was Francis Deng, who had been foreign minister for a while of Sudan, and Roberta Cohen. And they had this idea of sovereignty as, I think it was responsibility, they called it. And the whole idea that, and they wrote a lot about internally displaced persons, and the idea was to introduce this notion that with sovereignty came certain obligations. In several of my books, and as well, and I wrote a long article on it for Foreign Affairs, I basically wrote a piece about World Order 2.0. And the whole idea is we can't, that having a world order premised on that borders are critical and that sovereignty needs to be respected is necessary but not sufficient. And my argument was with sovereignty also comes obligations. Now, we have some of them, things like the Genocide Convention, there's human rights responsibilities. Now, we also have the idea that if you think about what the United States did after 9/11, we went to the Taliban, who were then the government of Afghanistan, and we said to them, in some cases it was I said to them, but it was also we said to them, hey, you are not fulfilling your obligations under international law if you allow terrorists to operate out of your territory. And if you allow terrorists to operate out of your territory, you can't expect to then for us to honor the benefits of sovereignty. You can't cherry pick it. You want the benefits of sovereignty, you got to meet the obligations of sovereignty. You don't meet the obligations, you don't get the benefits, i.e., we're coming in to get them and to get you. And when they wouldn't pledge to hand over al-Qaeda, we then attack. So and if you notice the document the Bush administration put out around them, essentially said, we draw no distinction between terrorists and those who harbor them. And again, the whole idea was, with sovereignty and the inviolability of your border, meant that you couldn't harbor people who were preparing to launch attacks across the borders of other countries. And I develop all sorts of other ideas in this article. Irina can get it to you. But I think it's an interesting idea. And then Charlie Kupchan and I wrote a subsequent article for Foreign Affairs where we try to also take some of these ideas and apply them to the idea of a modern-day concert, in some ways building on the ideas of the post-Napoleonic period and saying what would be the theme, who would be involved, what would be the themes of a modern-day concert. And we were advocating for it, and the conversation over it just stopped dead in the tracks for obvious reasons when Russia invaded Ukraine. So this is now a serious hiatus, if you will, towards anything like you're talking about, or I've been writing about, either the idea of sovereign obligations or the idea of a concert. But this too will pass, particularly if it's defeated. History does go a bit in cycles, and I think I would predict with more than a little confidence that the day will come when Russia is led by someone who denounces Vladimir Putin, who is seen as having driven Russia into a ditch, turned it into a pariah. Indeed, I think the day could conceivably come when some people around Tiananmen Square hold posters of Deng Xiaoping and basically hold posters advocating for a different kind of China, internally as well as in its relationship to the outside world. These things are not... So I actually think the day will come when it will again become not naive or whatever the word is. It'll always be ambitious to talk about the issues you're raising, which are what are the obligations, what ought to be the norms and rules that international relations operate on, and what do we do if and when those norms and rules are violated. 30 years ago, we had some hopes some of this might happen. I don't know if you remember, after the Iraqis invaded Kuwait, my boss at the time, President Bush, the father, H.W., talked about a new world order and never quite developed it, despite 12 memos to him suggesting how it might be developed. But there you go. But that day will come again. That moment will come again, particularly if we manage this crisis well. I feel that. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. I just want to say this has been really fabulous, and thank you to CFR.
Tell me who you are.
Susan Page from University of Michigan.
You're the second Susan Page I know. There's a Susan Page who, the newspaper, USA Today.
I know.
You are not that Susan Page.
I am not, but she interviewed me.
Really?
And it was Susan Page interviews Susan Page.
I love that.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
So thank you for hosting all of us. This has been really great. But just following on that last question, the notion of sovereignty and the rules-based order, and of course our background reading, which I did read, I mean, it sounds great from your perspective sitting there, But the rules-based order has not really worked so well for a whole lot of countries that we constantly are twisting their arms to go along with us when we have violated that same rules-based order. So how do we get to a place where the obligations that we talk about, which, you know, lots of us believe in and their intention with some other things, how do we accept that not everyone is going to agree with that world order?
Well, the answer is not everyone is going to agree to it. Again, a lot depends upon what are the norms or premises. If the idea is that you can't invade other countries, well, if we can't get people to line up to that one, then we don't got much. That's about as minimal as we have. And so I would say that's essential. And we ought to then think twice. One of the reasons I thought one of the many reasons I opposed the 2003 Iraq War is I didn't think that was I didn't think it was essential. It's one thing to do what I would describe, what's known in the literature, and there's a whole body of work, anticipatory self-defense or preemptive, I'm using the word preemptive strikes, where it's legitimate under international law in order to take action against an imminent threat you have real reason to believe is about to be delivered. You don't have to wait till you're hit. When the other guy takes his arm back, you're allowed to act. Okay, but that I did not believe Iraq qualified in 2003. So that was one of 18 reasons I thought that war was ill-advised. And when we do things like that, we weaken the fabric, which I think is what you're getting at. It makes it harder to talk the talk if we're not seen as walking the walk. And you're seen as hypocritical. It's like now, when this administration frames things as democracy versus authoritarianism, I go, that's a really bad idea. Can I just say that? It's one of the worst ideas to come down the pike for two reasons. One is, we're trying to persuade a lot of places that aren't democracies to agree with us. It's probably not the right going in position. And then secondly, it's not as though we're a model democracy these days. So much better to have democracy promotion by example than by lecturing. And so, yeah, so I think you make a good point that we ought to be mindful that everything we do carries certain weight beyond the immediate and the local. And we just ought to ask ourselves, if we're doing some things that are inconsistent with some of the norms we want to see, we ought to be real sure it's worth it, that the specifics warrant it, because you pay a price. I take your point. Yes, sir.
Kendra Acharya from Gonzaga University.
Gonzaga?
Yes. So
I root for you. I bet on you guys, and I root on you for you guys almost every year, and I, so come on, let's go.
Thank you. It didn't do very well this year.
Yeah, I noticed that you cost me some money this year.
But following up with Susan's thing, you know, the United States, when you said obligation, sovereignty as an obligation, not only as a right. So, yes, Afghanistan did not get the benefit as a sovereign state. Our sovereign country, because it did not hand over the Al-Qaeda at the time and provided or facilitated the training in Afghanistan and subject to invasion. But there was one thing that comparing, and you said brought the Iraq situation to, I'm just bringing comparison between Afghanistan and Iraq. Afghanistan, United States had that obligation, what you said, as sovereignty as an obligation. United States did not use that sovereignty as an obligation because even Iran had offered help to the US government during 9/11 incident. And there was a very good environment that this action, war on terror, could have been brought under the United Nations without any veto or any objection. I imagine. But the United States didn't take that route. United States government did not think at the time that as a sovereignty, as an obligation, we must follow international rule of law.
Well, excuse me, we did. We were following international rule of law because I was heavily involved in it. And we were doing it under Article 51 of the UN Charter.
Yes, we did.
Where we believed we had the right of self-defense. We did not know if there was another set of attacks to come from the Taliban who were still being harbored in Afghanistan. We were not about to take that risk.
I agree, but there was, United States had at the same time the opportunity to use the collective security option of the United Nations Charter too, rather than going to, okay, it is individual self-attack to us versus collective security problem, the global problem.
Well, we did use collective security again.
Two choices.
We did use collective security, excuse me.
Yes.
We're members of NATO. Article 5 under NATO was triggered, and that, again, was a form of collective security. So we were acting both under Article 51 and under Article 5 of the NATO Charter. Yeah. So we thought we were acting with quite a lot of commitment to
international
law.
We may have a little bit of disagreement here, because collective security under the NATO is regional. United Nations Charter collective security and NATO collective security are two different concepts, in my opinion.
Of course, anyway,
we can disagree on these things. Because United Nations Security Council...
Well, anyhow, you have a question. Let's get a question.
2003 now, then.
Let's get some questions.
Okay. That is one of my point. I think you answered that anyway, because... My anticipation was the collective security under the United Nations Charter, not as unilateral regional NATO defense treaty, collective defense treaty that many other countries are not there.
We clearly disagree on this question.
Okay. So that was, I think you answered me that. That was one of the obligations. And 2003, comparing that, we went to United Nations for the collective security purpose.
Right.
And then at that time, that is why it is important to bring that two things under the United Nations framework. And then 2003, the State Secretary went to the United Nations and presented this case and was not approved and had to take the self-defense argument, and that was beyond the even if anticipatory. How do we, that is what my question was.
Again, the answer is...
Did we miss the thing there from the sovereignty as an obligation? That is what I was thinking.
I don't think 2003, what the United States did was the right thing to do. I don't think it was warranted. And however it was justified, I thought it was unwarranted, and both on any terms, policy. So I'm not going to defend it. I disagreed with it at the time, and I wrote a book about it called War of Necessity, War of Choice. And that was the war of choice, and it was a choice I disagreed with. Sure.
I'm Sean Foreman, professor of political science from Barry University in Miami. And
name of it?
Barry University in Miami. What? B-A-R-R-Y, small Catholic school. I live by UM, but teach at Barry. And this is an amazing group. I have to say, the speakers, the participants, the humble ambassador page who slides these questions in there from time to time. No, but I'm beyond being a political science professor, one of my side projects is going into fifth grade classrooms, giving copies of the Constitution and talking about it.
Yeah.
And we do that around Miami. And I actually went also to my son's school last week, who's in fifth grade. And the teacher, as a gift, gave me a copy of the Bill of Obligations.
That is a good teacher.
She is. She was so excited to tell me about the book. I said, I heard about it. Thanks for the copy.
Thank you. Was
coming here.
You've made my day. Thank you.
So I read the first half. I haven't read the obligations yet.
Not that long.
I know. Grading lots of papers.
I mean, let's get real here.
But I see that numbers 1 and 2 are be informed, get involved.
Yes,
there was a longtime political reporter in Miami, Michael Putney for ABC, who just retired. At end of his public affairs show, every Sunday he would say, get informed, be informed, get involved.
Really?
So I've been doing that for years.
Is it plagiarism if you didn't know?
Be informed, get involved.
Didn't know, sorry, wow.
So my two questions on this are, number 10, and again, I'm sorry I haven't read it yet to see, but number 10 is...
Is this like a spoiler alert?
No. Put country
first.
You
want to know what happened in succession?
Put country first.
Yeah.
How does that fit into everything we're talking about, especially when we're going to be globally informed? And I'm thinking, you know, what is the best way to help bring about these obligations? Is it through civic, or is it through government, or is it some combination?
Two things. Thank you, first of all. Number 10 of the obligations is, it's almost like Article 10. It's the catch-all, and it's put country before party or person. And it was, I needed to have 10, first of all. It feels like Moses coming down. You know, 9 never would have done it. It's kind of like a Mel Brooks movie. Remember he was carrying 3 tablets, and, you know, damn, you know. Anyway, we won't go there, but it is one of the funnier scenes, though. It's kind of depressing that I felt the need to say put country before party or person. I would have thought it was self-evident, but it's not. I mean, the fact that, whether you like her politics or not, that Liz Cheney became the figure she did, or I thought there was, got less publicity, but like the secretaries of state of some of the states, basically the people who have to oversee elections, the process of voting, as well as the counting. The gentleman from Arizona, passionate, lifelong Republican, Trump supporter, but who still, quote unquote, did the right thing. That was, I thought, a wonderful moment. A great, great, great. But I felt the need to put it in there just because the fact that I can cite examples is a bad thing. It ought to be so common that you don't have to. So that's why. And also, you think, I mean, for me, Kennedy was the first president who I really remember. Because by the time he began, I was finally old enough. And so his inaugural, I can still remember watching the inaugural and what he said. You know, and I was young at the time, I was a kid. But anyone who's probably under the age, I don't know, 60 or 70, was born after Kennedy was killed. After, you know, 60 or so. So, and was just what is, wasn't politically. So it's just to, I wanted to get that out there. So that's why I put it in the, and it is a kind of catch-all. And the question is how to get these things. Look, some things can be done through public policy changes, two in particular. I would love to see public service much more incentivized in this country. Don't think mandated, because then we'd have a big debate about mandates. And Americans don't like to be told to do anything. And we don't need a draft and all that. But incentivized public service at the national and federal, even state level, state or even city level, I think makes a great idea. California is doing it now. I think they've got 4 pilot programs. One of the members of the governor's cabinet's in charge of volunteerism. Really talented guy named Josh Friday. You see it in Maryland. Wes Moore wants to. But I can think all sorts of, you'd pay people to do these things, and then they'd learn skills. Maybe they get preferential admissions for college, like veterans get benefits for jobs. But I think that would be great. The skills you'd pick up also would bring people together. I worry about the fact that Americans now have so few common or shared experiences. And public service is one way. I mean, so many people who went through World War II talk about that. If you read Tom Brokaw's stuff on The Greatest Generation, all that, it was a real bringing together. And now everybody has his or her own geography, church, you know, level of educational attainment, color, race, and social media site. It really worries me. So I think public service is it's not a panacea, but it's a useful thing. The other thing is, when I wrote the book, what I try to do, and as you'll see when you read the rest of the book, in the hour it will take, it's distributed, if you will, obligations, opportunities, what have you. Teachers, obviously, a big thing, but also, you know, parents, big thing. Business leaders, give people a few hours off to vote. Make it easy to vote. Make it easy for people to get leaves of absence, like universities do, to go work in government for a couple of years. Why contribute company money to politicians who deny democracy or advertise on outlets that give them voice? So business leaders can do that. They're pressured to do all sorts of things on sustainability. What about sustaining American democracy? Why is that so bad? Religious leaders, four of the obligations at least fit squarely in the religious space. Be civil, be open to compromise, nonviolence, no political disagreement warrants the use of violence. And fourthly, look out for the common good. Scripture teaches us we're our brothers and sisters' keeper, that we're part of a community, a society. We should be thinking, if you will, east-west, horizontally. So religious leaders, turns out, have a big role. So what I try to do with the obligation is think about not looking to politicians to save us. What I want to do is see how citizens can get more involved from whatever their own particular vantage point. Journalists obviously have special responsibilities, maybe to speak the truth. So that's what I've been thinking about, is how to, I don't think this is going to work if we wait for deliverance, if you will, from some great, exciting political figure. If one comes along who's a great, effective advocate for democracy, fantastic. But I don't think we have the luxury of waiting for that. And since there's enough disaffection out here, you know, this is the stuff of which populism gains root. And so what I try to do is come up with things that lots of quote-unquote ordinary folks, like everybody in this room, that all of us can do. And, you know, and parents can do stuff across the dining room table and so forth. So, you know, going back to de Tocqueville, what's so good about his stuff is, you know, again, his appreciation of American democracy and society was very ground up. All the associational things. And so there's nothing miraculous about this. It's really decentralized, and lots of us have, or all of us have, the ability, to beginning with voting. I mean, if you think about it, 55% of eligible voters did not vote in the midterms. And so I'm from New York State, live here, have a place upstate. Turns out that Republicans won four or five districts that are traditionally Democratic. I'm not saying that's a good thing or a bad thing, but I am saying it did lead to the Republicans gaining the House. Small numbers of people voting in those areas of New York State would have made the difference, and you'd now have a Democratic House. You can say, I'm not saying it's a good thing or a bad thing, I'm just saying it's a thing. My point is simply that small amounts of political activity can have outsized impact. Presidential elections, what is the last, you know, we've had several now, where 100,000 votes distributed in a couple of places would have come with a different outcome given the nature of the Electoral College. So a slightly greater amount of political participation could have a dramatic impact. So what I want to give people is the sense of possibility. It's almost to shake them out of being sanguine and at the same time infuse them with a sense of possibility. So it's a mixed message. I am getting the look that every husband gets when it's time to go. And as every man in this room will understand. And so, Irina, what is it we need to do?
Now a 10-minute break, and the next session will start at 3:15. So you can have a little stand up, stretch your legs, and come right back. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you all.